Sometimes I'd be right in your face and hit like Genjutsu and play. That's how it be though. Nothing but greater effort just to get a C though. Eyes watching, but we never seem to be though. The latest episodes of My Hero Academia, especially the latest one, what happened with Deku being unable to save Bakugo, is a very valuable lesson, not only amongst, you know, the context of the story and heroes, but in general, I think a lot of people can take a lesson out of that in a more metaphoric way. No matter how much you want to do something, no matter how much you try and give it your all, sometimes you just can't save everyone. Now, granted, I'm not speaking in terms of that Bakugo is evil now. We don't know what he's gonna do, how he's gonna react. Well, if you read the manga, you do, but, you know, anime onlys don't know what's about to go down with Bakugo. But what I mean is, he tried his best, and he even said it, yo, I was right in front of him, and I couldn't save him, because obviously his arms were completely destroyed, his body was destroyed, and he just couldn't get to him in time to do anything. Even though he was right there, he couldn't move his arms, because they were destroyed from the fight with Musculus. So it definitely is a testament to, you can care, and you can try and be a hero, and you can try and do the right thing, but some people are beyond your reach. And I think metaphorically, that is a really powerful message. Overall, oh man, so let's talk a little bit, because these few episodes leading up until this one, I think the last two or three in particular, we got a lot into a lot of the characters that are in Class 1A. With My Hero Academia, one of the things that it always attempts to do, sometimes it succeeds, sometimes it's a little bit, but is give development to all of Class 1A. If in one arc certain characters don't get the spotlight, the next arc they will. And while, you know, there was a little bit of Todoroki trying his best and all of that stuff, it was cool to see some of the other characters yet again, like Tokoyami, get spotlight and really dive into, holy shit, like for starters, his quirk, when it went wild and it was just attacking everything indiscriminately, I was like, okay. it just showcases though, imagine once he gets that under control and it doesn't matter what time of day it is, what is he around, that he can use that power for his own. He is going to be one of the strongest heroes around, because that power alone, it was like the villains that, you know, some of our class were struggling against, they really couldn't do anything to Tokoyami. When he went wild, they were crushed and destroyed like nothing, which again is a testament to Tokoyami is going to be one hell of a player once he can get that under control, which obviously that showcases that he got a ways to go, character development, physically and all that stuff, to get to where he needs to be. But it's just foreshadowing that he could be one of the top heroes in all of 1A. Let's talk a little bit about something that started, not a rumor, I guess a little bit of foreshadowing as well, when it was brought up that there's possibly a traitor. This is something big in My Hero Academia, because now you got to start questioning, well, who could it be? Is it one of the students? Is it one of the teachers? Who could have said, yo, they're here, come get them or whatever? Well, you got to start looking, because at the end of the day, it's really hard to, especially with stories like this, because nobody in particular immediately sticks out. And a lot of the times, especially with anime and manga, or just in general, when somebody's trying to do some covert operation, they are going to play it to the T. If you've read Attack on Titan, which obviously I'm not giving any spoilers, but some people put on the most incredible poker face to get to where they're trying to go. So even if you think, well, that guy's an oddball, it might be him, it could be her, you just don't know, because it could be anybody and they're putting on a good poker face. I mean, Aizawa sensei was really doing his thing, and I know I'm kind of deviating a little bit from that, but that's a powerful thing, you know what I'm saying? Just overall, that whole scenario of now we gotta have distrust in people, I think there's some people you could cross off the list, like All Might ain't betraying anyone, Aizawa sensei, nah, it's not him, like right there you take those two off the table. But there's still quite a few other people. I mean, for all we know, the principal, the little happy rat looking motherfucker, he could be the traitor, which is doubtful or whatever, but there's possibility there. And then amongst the students, I'm going to 110% say, and if I'm wrong, then so be it, but nobody in Class 1A is a traitor. Like, they're not built like that, you know what I'm saying? They're the new Konoha 11, the rookie 9, so to speak. There's not a traitor in there. If anybody is a traitor, it's more than likely that subconsciously they have no knowing of it. You know, maybe there's some villain that has used a quirk that is allowing them to probably manifest in them without the person knowing it, but I don't think anyone in Class 1A would do it. So it'd have to be somebody from another class or one of the teachers, something along the lines of that, because I just don't see it happening. I don't see these people that are grouped together. I mean, I guess it could happen, and that'd be the greatest shock in the world of like,
whoa, you know what I'm saying? That's betrayal in its finest, but it's a tough one. Let's talk quickly the fact that Bakugo and Tokoyami were the two people that were targeted so that they could bring them to that side. To be honest with you, the fact that it was only Bakugo got dragged away, which again, we don't know if he's gonna say, yo, I'm on that Sasuke Uchiha, bring me my Orochimaru, we about to, you know what I'm saying? But we don't know about Bakugo, but let's speak on Tokoyami because again, he was the one that got rescued or whatever. I think, honestly, there's a possibility that Tokoyami, because he seems more fragile-minded, because whenever something bad happens, he feels real guilty. Like when the one dude, which sometimes the names escape me, but dude with all the arms or whatever, when the dude got his arm, you know, one of his arms was ripped off or whatever, Tokoyami felt incredible guilt, and that's what brought out that monster. Let's just say they can really brainwash Tokoyami and really put it in his head like this and that. I think between that and trying to overcome his quirk and the powers that it has or whatever, I think Tokoyami would have been a really bad villain, or a great villain but a bad villain, like a strong villain, because he just seems that he's not weak-minded in terms of like, yo, he's a follower or whatever, but the guilt really would have just warped him and made him feel like, yo, I have this power like this for a reason. Maybe I should just be a villain. Maybe I'm not cut out to be a hero. So thankfully, Tokoyami wasn't brought forth into the whole, you know, villain association. Which, let's talk a little bit about some of the villains. Oh my god. Oh, Togo, she's such a beauty, I ain't gonna lie. Like, I know she's crazy, I know she's insane, but when she's attacking and trying to get the blood, it's such an interesting character, because we have all these clean-cut people, minus Bakugo, you know, a couple, but, you know, Class 1A and the students of, you know, UA in general, it's such a different dynamic to see. She is an example of what if you were not brought into the fold of a great school and being around good people, and she's a psycho, trying to get the blood and all that shit. Like, I really adore that character. I think Dobby is another really cool character as well, seen as flames or whatever. Like, it's interesting to see how, in a way, the villains in My Hero Academia have to be really crafty, because realistically, even Shigaraki said, if they go straight up like, yo, let's go after All Might, let's go after Endeavor, let's go after the big dogs, they will get crushed. So that's why they have to do these small operations of like, okay, only a couple of these people and none of the big dogs is going to be there, let's strike now. So it's kind of like the villains aren't at that level to put a full-on assault yet, but they can do things like this, which really messes things up. Look at the reputation of the school. One of their students got kidnapped. Like, any school ever, even in our world, you know what I'm saying? If a kid gets kidnapped, bad reputation, especially that's the number one hero school in the world. So the fact that it went down like that, they did their damage, made a major hit against them, to the point where I think that's the biggest damage they've done thus far. Like, even excluding the invasion in the first time and anything they've done, this one, they ruined the reputation, they captured one of the kids, and all around people got seriously hurt. The Pussycat Dolls, like, they got bodied. Which, is it the Pussycat Dolls? I don't know, the cat living bitches, whatever, they got bodied. And then Aizawa again, like, yo, he was trying or whatever, but Dobby and everything that was going down, like, they were putting in the works. The whole forest is on fire and everything, like, they put in the works. Deku, some people will argue like, man, yo, how much energy you have. I think it was perfectly explained, because I have seen criticism of people saying like, it's unrealistic, like, why is Deku still moving? But he really couldn't save Bakugo in the end, you know what I'm saying? And he was running off adrenaline, he couldn't move his arms. So Deku definitely is going to pay the price for what he's done in terms of pushing his body beyond its limits, which I like stuff like that, because it showcases, even though anime likes to push positive message of like, you know, with Dragon Ball, break your limits, go beyond your limits, sometimes when you break your limits, you break your body. And that's what happened with Deku, and it goes back to a lesson that he's been trying to understand and gauge throughout all of My Hero, is that you're nothing if all you do is break your body after a few blows. You're nothing, why are you even bothering? So that's still a reoccurring theme for Deku, which, I mean, he had to do what he had to do. What else could he have done? Muscular was going to annihilate him. We see on the villain side, they did take a couple L's. Muscular is captured, a couple people got bodied or whatever, so all around there was a bit of damage on both sides, but the heroes took a bigger blow, because now on top of all that, the villain association have more clout, more notoriety, they're more out there now, which is all playing into Shigaraki's hands. I'm a lot. All Might, for one of the first times, he gave me a little bit of a scary vibe when he was on the phone and he was like, yo, we're about to strike back, boy. I was like, okay, I see you, bro. All around My Hero Academia, especially the last few episodes and the latest episode, just powerful stuff. Seeing our heroes almost feeling helpless, like, yo, we want to do something. How can we get back our friend? Even though Bakugo's an asshole, which showcases they're real heroes, you know what I'm saying? In our world, when somebody is that mean and that asshole-ish to us, we're like, do I really care that they got captured? You know what I'm saying? But no, they're like, yo, we're heroes at the end of the day. Seeing Kirishima, which I don't know if anybody watches the dub of My Hero Academia. I love watching the dub because they're doing little interesting, cool things that probably people aren't picking up. Like, I think, again, it's Kirishima that he's being voiced by Justin Cook, voice of Yusuke Urameshi from Yu Yu Hakusho. I hear John Bergemeyer in there. He's done, if I'm not mistaken, Kurama and George from Yu Yu Hakusho. And they've done other roles, whatever. But it's nice that they're bringing forth some of the old cast of, like, you know, the classics, and having them, even if they're filling in B-roles, to just kind of support the new gen of shonen anime. So I think that's a nice touch with the dub. Dub is solid as hell, I ain't gonna lie. I really enjoy it. And all around these episodes, yes, really, really awesome to see, because especially if you go early on in My Hero, it was like, man, can the villains even do anything? You got All Might in here just grabbing motherfuckers by the neck, beating up on the normals, and like, can they do anything? So to see that they actually struck, and Shigaraki didn't even have to have his hands directly dirtied, really cool stuff. Now, I'm gonna warn you guys, okay, for anime onlys, without spoilers, but I am gonna warn you, very soon, it is about to get even more hype. And one of the best moments, probably the best moment of all of My Hero Academia, is coming. I don't know if it's in 2-3 episodes, whatever, but brace yourselves, because it's about to get real. Again, all around My Hero Academia, keep it up, man. We got some L's on our side. The villains took L's. I think, if anything, some of the small aspects that people will probably argue is like, a lot of the fake outs was like kind of whatever. But honestly, there's not much really to critique. Art and animation on point, especially when you're coming from like that last episode I talked about, the Muscular versus Deku fight, which was godlike animation. You can't really complain. Seeing Deku, his spirit is kind of broken and shit, it teaches him another valuable lesson that is all around, in turn, gonna add to his character development and make him stronger and better. And I can't wait to see it. Kind of curious what you guys think about this, though. What do you think? Who took the bigger L's? The villains or the heroes? I think it's, without a doubt, the heroes took the bigger L. Also, Bakugo, for anime-only viewers, do you think Bakugo is about to go the Sasuke route and say, fuck that shit, yo, I'm villain for life, yo, he's about to be turning up with Shigaraki and shit? Or you think it's about to be that he's gonna say no? What do you think All Might has in store? Because now they have the tracker from, you know, Momo sent the tracker. Do you think All Might is just gonna bust in there and start choking motherfuckers up? Like, oh, by the way, I just mentioned Momo. Oh my god, I'm so sorry you went through something, girl. No, my Momo. And your overall thoughts, My Hero Academia still on fire, and that My Hero Academia greatness. But that's all I have for this one. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed. If you liked anything I had to say or enjoyed the video, throw me a like. I'd greatly appreciate it. And if you want more from me, make sure to subscribe. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and stalk my Facebook to get more when the video ends. I'm Fenever World. And as always, people, have an awesome day. And remember the golden rule. Anime and manga for life, boy. Pow. Have an awesome day. Yo, them L's, though. Them L's. Making major moves. Laughing at the haters lose. We don't give a fuck. Favorite, but never matter how you move.